This whole time I thought changing the world was something you did. An act you perform. Something you fought for. I don't know if that's true anymore. What if changing the world was just about being here? By showing up, no matter how many times we get told we don't belong. By staying true, even when we're shamed into being false. By believing in ourselves, even when we're told we're too different. And if we all held on to that, if we refused to budge and fall in line, if we stood our ground for long enough, just maybe, the world can't help but change around us. Even though we'll be gone, it's like Mr. Robot said, we'll always be a part of Elliot Alderson. And we'll be the best part. Because we're the part that always showed up. We're the part that stayed. We're the part that changed him. And who wouldn't be proud of that?
Just show up, and the world will change with you. Be present in everything and all that you are. Well said, Elliot Anderson. Played by the Freddie Mercury / Night at the Museum dude. And what a scene from the Gnostic-themed Mr. Robot, where all the personality fragments of Elliot unite during his literal saving of the world. Can we change the world? Save it? Well, like Elliot, you must realize something. All your complexes, all your shadows, all your bad memories, the voices in your head, all your trauma is not there to punish or torture you, but to teach you, wake you up fully. Become integrated in you for that primary gnosis that you have a purpose.
You decide what is real and what is not. You. Your will.
In other words, when you unite your inner world, you'll be able to make a true difference in the outer world. Just show up. All of the yous, because they're all amazing, because they've gone through so much to tell a story that matters. The world will then change. Oh, you freaks and outcasts, you of the broken places. I mean, in Thunder the Perfect Mind, the protagonist exposes all of her aspects. From the heights of being a goddess to the lows of being humiliated as a mortal rape victim. And everything in between. She embraces them, unites them, and shows them to a fallen creation. And in that tender honesty and savage assimilation, that acceptance of all that she went through in the pain-ridden growth that is becoming wisdom, she is victorious.
I was pressed down like coal. I suffered. That's what an angel is. Dust pressed into a diamond by the weight of this world.
Or as Jesus says in the Gospel of Thomas, after the disciples ask him if they shall enter the Father's kingdom as innocent babes. When you make the two into one, and when you make the inner like the outer, and the outer like the inner, and the upper like the lower, and when you make male and female into a single one, so that the male will not be male, nor the female be female, when you make eyes in the place of an eye, a hand in the place of a hand, a foot in place of a foot, an image in place of an image, then you will enter the kingdom.
Every man is born as many men and dies as a single one. Heidegger.
Integration. Wholeness. Every part of your psyche is rooting for you, just like the aeons are. and wants you to show it to the world and thus change the world. Or as Jesus also says in the Gospel of Thomas, if you bring forth what is within you, what you have will save you. If you have nothing within you, what you do not have within you will kill you.
Do you want to take a leap of faith or become an old man filled with regret, waiting to die alone?
Ready to be like Elliot Alderson or Thunder? Then welcome to Aeon Bitnostic Radio. Welcome to that dream of you, that distant ship smoke on the horizon. It's all fun and games until someone loses a third eye, and then it's just gnosis.
Psychotic drowns where the mystic swims.
I am your host and pompous of gnosis, Miguel Connor. Getting over a brutal month where all my complexes, shadows, memories, trauma, the voices in my head, kicked my ass to some hellish depths. But like you, I'm listening, integrating, and becoming wiser. My inner world continues to be discovered. I'm not going anywhere.
None of you seem to understand. I'm not locked in here with you.
You're locked in here with me!
So many amazing astral guests bring us the wisdom of the ages in this age of Hermes, Philip K. Dick world, and Gnostic times. So much magic and lore to draw upon, from past magicians, timeless myths, and our very ancestors speaking to us as much as the voices in our head. Our ancestors want a better world too. A holy Mandela effect.
And what if you could go back in time and take all those hours of pain and darkness and replace them with something better?
Thus, it's an honor to have back at the virtual Alexandria, Stephen Flowers, who will discuss his latest book, Revival of Runes. Get ready to walk away from Omelas, because Stephen will take us on a potent history of runes, which means to a journey of European myth, magic, and meaning. What a scholar and what a friend of occultism Stephen is. A Valis knight for the truth, always bringing ancient mysteries to a modern meaning. If runes are your cup of tea, then this show also doubles as a means to make better inner and outer worlds, just as many other tools and traditions provided here at Aeon Byte. Whatever works for you, just make sure it works, as my friend Jim says.
Can I raise a practical question at this point?
Yeah.
Are we going to do Stonehenge tomorrow?
No, we're not going to fucking do Stonehenge!
I'm not totally sure if we can save the world, but we can heal it at least, perhaps make it more interesting. But I do like this quote from Caitlin Johnstone, my favorite crypto-gnostic. You can't vote your way out of a mess that you didn't vote your way into. Nobody voted to let oligarchs control the government and tilt the entire political system to their advantage. Nobody asked your permission to steal your country. Don't ask their permission to take it back.
In the councils of government, we must guard against the acquisition of unwarranted influence, whether sought or unsought, by the military-industrial complex. We must also be alert to the equal and opposite danger that public policy could itself become the captive of a scientific, technological elite.
And as Caitlin said of spirituality, false spirituality offers sedation and escapism from reality. It is very convenient for the powerful. True spirituality means expanding consciousness of reality. Consciousness of our inner dynamics and outer dynamics, which lead to suffering. Nearly all spirituality today is false. False spirituality helps you hide the ugly truths within and without, by offering comforting narratives and practices which help sedate your emotional body. True spirituality brings consciousness to those ugly truths, within and without, and brings them into the light to be seen. The powerful benefit from false spirituality. They say, use mindfulness and deep breathing exercises to help you cope with the stress of a meaningless, exploitative job. They glorify meekness, obedience, and poverty, and extol us to forgive those who have committed great evils.
I want to become a guru so girls will like me. Then I will like myself.
True spirituality is the last thing the powerful would ever want to go mainstream, because it means waking up to reality.
The first noble truth is life is suffering, but the Buddha preached joyful participation in the sorrows of the world.
Inner and outer reality, my beloved truth seekers. Stop denying your potential and letting others dictate what parts of you to express. Start listening to that hidden universe of ripping stars that are meant to be your Dionysian fuel, even if it's painful and scary at times. Start looking at those around you who are waking up instead of worrying about non-player characters out there. Then we will meet the powerful, those butt slaves of that wickedness in high places, in the battlefield of the true seeker warrior. And, well, at least, at the very minimum, make the world more interesting and help the least of our brothers.
I fought the good fight. I finished the race. I kept the faith.
We'll be like Elliot Alderson, who by name and character Mr. Robot is an obvious cipher to, yes, Thomas Anderson or Neo in The Matrix. Let's do it. And Stephen Flowers always opens doors of perception to the call of our ancestors, at least those who stood up to the empire that never ended. But first, tell us more gnosis, Elliot and Mr. Robot.
There are some people out there, and it doesn't happen a lot. It's rare. But they refuse to let you hate them. In fact, they care about you in spite of it. And the really special ones, they're relentless at it. Doesn't matter what you do to them, they take it and care about you anyway. They don't abandon you, no matter how many reasons you give them. No matter how much you're practically begging them to leave. And you want to know why? Because they feel something for me that I can't. They love me. And for all the pain I've been through, that heals me. Yeah, and there are setbacks. We do fucked up things to each other. And we hurt each other and it gets messy. But that's just us. In any world you're in. And yeah, you're right. We're all told we don't stand a chance. And yet, we stand. We break, but we keep going, and that is not a flaw. It's
what makes us. So no, I will not give up on this world. And if you can't see why, then I speak for everyone when I say, fuck you!
This is the AM Byte interview, and with us, we are glad to have back Dr. Stephen Flowers to discuss his new book, Revival of the Runes, The Modern Rediscovery and Reinvention of the Germanic Runes. Stephen, how are you? And thank you very much for coming back on.
Oh, well, thank you. I'm doing well, and I'm happy to discuss this new book with you.
Yeah, I enjoyed your book very much and definitely fascinated. Oh, yeah. I want to look further into this. And with us, too, we have the Moondog Vance. Vance, how are you doing?
Oh, I'm fine. I'm looking forward to a good show, and I hope I don't ruin it.
The puns. Oh, oh, oh.
Like Tony Curtis in the Vikings says, what did the ruins say?
Oh, my God, that's great. I forgot about that. Oh, what a classic. Wonderful. Well, I'm sure we got more puns out there. What I wanted to start it out with, Stephen, is that in your book, Revival of the Runes, you talk about how you were an undergraduate student at the University of Texas in Austin, 1974. And you sort of had an idea, and 10 years later, you got your PhD with the dissertation Runes and Magic. And how do you feel about this? I always like to think of Carl Jung, who said, you don't have ideas, ideas have you. Do you think that's what happened? Mm-hmm. You were called to take this path.
Oh, yeah. Another Jungian phrase or whatever. It's a terrible thing to fall into the hands of a living God.
Oh, yeah.
And, that's, as I say about the experience where I just sort of heard this word, runa, in my ear, just like, oh, what was that, in a kind of unguarded moment. And it was just this one word. But as I often have said, when people say, well, God was talking to me the other day, and he said, and then he was telling them what, how to invest their money or whatever. It's like, no, when a God, if a God ever spoke to you, probably one word would be enough. And from that one thing, everything else comes. Everything else. If you unpack that one experience, it will last you a lifetime.
And this is something, yeah, and I'm sure, have you enjoyed this path of the runes and the Germanic religion and all that? Has it been great, or has it been, like, well, some, yeah, say, just, it's been challenging?
It's, as the German philosopher Fichte, sort of his watchword was, become who you are. And that's sort of what I think the journey has been. That is, just discovering who a person actually is. But that also involves, if you're talking about, as I was interested in, and a lot of people have been, spiritual, mythic quests and so forth, that I have found that becoming and exploring what is related to my ancestry has been the path that I took. And so I was interested in those days, as most people, starting off in sort of occult explorations, one gets enamored of the Kabbalah and that sort of thing, and what then Jewish mysticism and such. And I was at the time married to a Jewish woman of Jewish background, I'll put it that way. And so I got to know some people in her family and so forth, who were into Kabbalah and all that, old guys, old characters. But and it soon became obvious to me, almost instantly, that these people were becoming who they were. I mean, this was genuine thing. And I could never be that, because I was not that, right? It was not my ancestral path, as it were. So I could see, or it also reminds me of how, when I was just a little kid, 7 years old, we took a trip to the Grand Canyon out through Route 66. This was in 1961 or something. And I saw these American Indians, Zuni, Hopi, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And I was just struck by this authenticity, even as a seven-year-old child, right? And a lot of people see this, whether it's Kabbalah or in the American Indians or whatever, and they try to become that. And if you then speak to these people who have an authentic ancestral tradition, of course they just sort of look at you, if they're honest and not just trying to market their thing to yeah. To others, you know, they will say, you know, what are you doing? Why are you, you know, jumping on what people today in this world call cultural appropriation or whatever right, it ends up being. But say, so I didn't know anything about that kind of stuff, but it was just, I want to have that same kind of authenticity in a spiritual path. And so it was, there is no, well, I wonder what that might be when you're honest and truthful. I mean, it could be Celtic, it could be Germanic or whatever. But since, for example, we are now speaking a Germanic language and our the grammar of this language we're now speaking and so forth and so on, the structures of it, which have hardwired our brains, actually, is from that, which we've inherited from this Germanic grammar, if you will, that it has structured our way of processing information, that's what your mother language will do. If you grow up bilingual, you could be have two, but that's part of who we are. Mm-hmm. So the idea of nature versus nurture has been sort of shown by people here recently to be kind of a false dichotomy, in the sense that we do have DNA and all that, but also because the human brain is developing at the fetal rate, actually. That's why the skull of the little baby is not closed yet for a couple of years after that. And it's really not completed, the brain growth. It's being hardwired. It's being constructed for the first 5 or 6 years of life. What else is going on in those years? You're acquiring and mastering your native language. And so the brain is constructed, not just sort of influenced by, or it's part of the hardware of your body, is this influence, blueprint, if you will, that's inserted into the brain. And so all of that goes back. We need to then look at mythology to say, this is the path of that I have, am, that it constitutes who I am. And so that's been much of what I have done for myself, and then my works are efforts to communicate this to others.
Well said, and we are very grateful of all the work you've done on this background, and I agree with you, we must become who we are, but don't you agree, I love a multicultural society, but I do believe everyone should honor and embrace their ancestors. Every culture has a great mythology and wisdom and contribution, and in a way, our ancestors are calling to us to honor them and say, hey, look what we did and what we can still do for you.
Mm-hmm. Yes, that's ancestral, and that's where my model, people get involved in. So my tradition, this Germanic thing, has been so beset by and plagued by, because of events of the 20th century, of nationalistic feelings and nationalistic sentiments and that sort of thing. And that is contrary to the actual ancestral pattern. We are tribal, not national. We're more family, clan, tribe. That's where the essence lies. The idea of nationality or, quote, race, end quote, is not anything that was a category in the ancestral mind, right? Just like right. people make into, for example, the Battle of Clontarf, where the supposedly, so the myth goes, the modern myth, whether you're, especially among Irish nationalists, you know, this is where Brian Boru, you know, ejected those Norse and defeated the Norse in this battle and, you know, established Irish nationhood or whatever, that kind of a thing. But the fact is, there were as many Norsemen in Brian Boru's army or warriors as there were Irish. And on the other side, there was many Irish in the Norse contingent as there was otherwise. These people owed allegiance to their lords regardless of, quote, nationality. It wasn't a category for these people. They belonged to a tribe. If they were a part of a retinue or a warrior band, then they owed absolute allegiance to their lord. But nobody was thinking in national terms. That just wasn't a category for them. But in modern times, 19th century and following, this whole thing gets rewritten in a way that has been obviously very counterproductive, because national level of things is too large to be on an intimate relationship with. And so it becomes then something that inauthentic propagandists, political operatives, etc., can manipulate and make fools out of us by appealing to things which are not even real. And so we get led down, and people all over the world, all groups, everywhere, you know, you can go everywhere and you see this kind of a trend. But if you see that you want to relate to ancestors, family, ancestors, and also your own body, as I consider it, when you think about fourth dimensional realities, hyperspace, hypercubes, tesseracts, etc. Right. I mean, our bodies are kind of, you look at the body as a kind of a hyperbody. That is, that it has all of the information in it of its entire ancestry. And so it's just lying there, latent. But and that's where Jung, for example, originally, he said, well, we can reactivate through active imagination, etc., reactivate this information and gain access to that unconscious part of ourselves. But if done, as my personal experience, if done in a genuine way, you have you're made your soul safe from all of these terrible, you know, manipulations that sometimes politicians try to put you into. However, I'm most saddened by just over my lifetime about how much our tradition has been hijacked by political types, right and left, you could say. You know, the PC crowd or the nationalist crowd, everybody's just like done a disservice to the whole thing. It's a great disappointment. But that's where I have put my efforts, which has always been there. I was never sort of moved to create a huge movement. Rather, my concentration from the beginning has been on initiatory relationships within what is the guild, within a, so it's like a trade guild, but we trade in the secrets, in the mysteries, and that's our subject matter, and that's what the Rune Guild is, and I am incredibly satisfied and happy with the success of that organization, especially now that it's, I no longer lead it directly. It's in the hands of others who are just carrying on in an exemplary fashion. And that whole story is told in a book put out by Arcana Europa called The History of the Rune Guild. And this book that we're talking about mainly today, Revival of the Runes, is sort of history of the Rune Guild, as it were. And it does touch on the Rune Guild at the end, but in the time between the demise of the runic tradition, that is the Christianization of Europe, and so the context of the original guild of rune masters was lost, and then people start to try to revive it, but it's a stumbling, bumbling story about how people didn't know what they were doing for centuries, really. But there, the urge to do it was there, but the either the raw data for doing it, or the motivation wasn't there, or the data wasn't there, or it was confusing to people, including scholars, of course.
Yeah, well, we're very happy you've done this work. I think we need constant clarity. I mean, for example, runes are still very popular. Modern fantasy, modern occultism. I watched the show WandaVision, and at the end they're using runes and throwing it out there. Obviously, a long time ago, I used to play Dungeons and Dragons. So of course, runes was always part of our campaign. Gary Gygax never brought the Kabbalah or Greek Gematria, but man, he could hit you with the runes. And even recently, there was that controversy at CPAC with the stage. I don't know if you're aware of it.
Where yeah, the I saw sta- somebody.
And I was like, I wonder if somebody gonna interview Dr. Flowers and ask him what his opinion is on.
Oh Lord! I responded on a Facebook thing about it. I said, man, that's like, this belongs to the same thing, the same crowd or same kind of mindset that, you know, sees messages from God in the shapes of clouds, or like, look at us.
Jesus on a toast.
The rock. You know, that rock is speaking to me, you know, it's that kind of thing like that. You know, if privately, that is, there's a lot of things which you wouldn't, which a magician, a magical person, initiate, etc., such as I would say I am myself, and you probably are, and a lot of people are. There's a category of knowledge or communication, just like the word the runa story. It doesn't, the experience, the subjective experience is one thing, but if by what it means, it is borne out by what actions it causes you to do. And then you measure its validity, importance, power, etc., from that, but it's more like a poetic reality that then becomes the motivation for bigger and better things, or it can just lead to stupidity, insanity, and delusion, which is usually where those kind of things go. And that's where discipline and initiatory and tradition and so forth come in. The runic revival was fraught, has been fraught, it continues to be, by the greatest nonsense in the world, where people such as the famous everybody knows of Ralph Blum. I write about him in the book, and of course that was a big breakthrough. I had actually written a book on runes and rune magic and so forth when I was still just a pup, you know, in 1975. So I heard the word in 74. By the next year, I'd completed a book. It was largely a translation and a digested form of the Armanen tradition of contemporary Germany. And it was said, okay, in 1975, we're going to get you. I've had a deal, a handshake deal with Prentice Hall, you know, to publish this thing and all of that. And then time goes by, and they say, well, I talked to the marketing people, and they just don't think we can sell runes.
What?
This was 1975. Yeah. Now, what I see there, in retrospect, and saw pretty quickly, is that this Armanen thing was not authentic. It's not the authentic runic tradition. It's a interesting 20th century phenomenon in Germany, Guido von Liszt, etc. But it's not the thing that I was intended to find. That runa, that the old man, as I call Odin, was directing me towards. And so, again, going back to Jung, it's a terrible thing to fall into the hands of a living God, mm-hmm. is that this entity said, boom, I break your sword. I'm going to make you fail, you know, because this is the wrong path. So it was over, you know, and then so forth. And so that was, and then I started to study Old Norse to do the language and all that, and got into academia, discovered much more about that, got mentors, and became, and quickly saw what I was really intended to do, to go deeper. It's like, go back to school. You're not finished. You think you're so smart. You think you've done something here, but it's the wrong thing. So I'm going to cause you to fail, and I'm going to set you on the right path. And, or you just have to find that right path for yourself one way or the other. And so that's what happened with me. But a lot of times, being thwarted is exactly the thing that needs to happen. And so that's how I transitioned into a more authentic path. But all those things are happening pretty rapidly when you look at the, when I think of how time goes by so quickly now as you grow older, and how much happened in my younger life, where a lot of things happen in a short space of time. And so we're talking about just a few years here, and went from one thing to the other quickly. But that's always important to focus on, I think, is what am I supposed to do? I mean, what is my, as I've said before, people say, oh, I wish I could just do magic and just make things happen. Well, you know, would you really tonight say, well, what do I want? What do I want to do? What do I want? What do I want? And if you could just wave that magic wand and make it happen, you know, are you wise enough? Do you know the unintended consequences of success? And in my case, this example, the unintended consequence of success would have been if that book had been published in 1975, sure, I would have had to jump on old Ralph Blum by far, right? By years. Yeah. Actually, he got the idea indirectly through, you know, I'd circulated the manuscript in many places, and that's where it got the idea. Runes are, probably we can sell them, but this guy's book is not popular enough, you know, so I think that's what happened, honestly. But in any event, if I had had quote success at that point, I would have been sort of locked in a way, or had this albatross around my neck of this inauthentic product, mm-hmm. which I would probably have been popular, probably would have sold after all, but it would have been a tragedy, really, to be saddled with this kind of inauthentic product. And so actually, of course, it was good. I wasn't wise enough. I waved my, that's wrong. That is not going to be beneficial in the long term. But most people think, well, I'm just going to make things happen, you know, and what I want right now. But I think few people are ever quite wise enough to really have their magic result in them being happy because the power can often exceed the wisdom.
Yeah, well said. It reminds me of what, again, going back to Jung, he said, we didn't come to this world to be happy. We came to be whole. And I think Jung said, free will is doing exactly what you're supposed to do, what your psyche has it, what the people in Thelema call the true will, or the Hermetics call your will. We all have a destiny, and it's right there. And going against it is like Jonah trying to resist Yahweh. It just brings a lot of pain. And I've been that way too. I've gone away from, I know what my path is, and I just let my ego take me to some bad places, unfortunately.
Yeah, that's, it's a struggle, but the struggle is part of the story also. If it was all easy, then it wouldn't be, it literally really wouldn't be much of an adventure, wouldn't be much of a story to tell at the end of the day.
Oh, yeah, agreed. And, so moving on to your book, for those who might not know, again, it's not just the revival, but you do a great job of giving us a description of the history of runes and how they came into being, and how, well, there was a fall, a deterioration in its interest. But I'm fascinated. You write in one section, Stephen, that the runes were probably invented, and it wasn't Odin, by one individual based on Mediterranean script, probably between 150 and BC and 150 CE. That's a fascinating, how does somebody come into that theory?
Well, because this is not a mystical or magical theory, it's just a scholarly theory or consensus for the most part. And it lies in the fact that the runic record, the inventory of the symbols, shows an uncanny regularity of the number of signs, the order of the signs, and that through various tribes that used them, that the earliest examples, this consistency is there. And so, when compared to the history of other alphabetic systems, the order, for example, the Greek alphabet or other Etruscan, any kind of alphabet you want to compare it to, the early history of these things often show quite a jumble of order and number of letters and so forth. We think of the Greek alphabet by this time when the runes were shaped, the Greek alphabet had settled down to a 24 symbol system, but before that it had been various numbers of letters and put in different orders, etc. You could learn an alphabet, just say, well, that symbol has this sound, that symbol has that sound, but the idea of putting them into a definite order is sort of a school, implies that there's a school involved that's teaching this order, recite your alphabet, and so forth, and they will sing this little song to learn it, and all of that sort of thing. But the idea that this consistency across tribal boundaries, a consistency, it is anomalous, really, in the history of alphabetic systems, just when you compare it to others, the earliest phase of it. And so this then results in people believing that it must have been an individual inventor who was a person who was well-placed or became well-placed in the culture due to his invention. Of prestige. Prestige is the greatest power in culture.
Right.
Not force or violence, but prestige. This system spread in a school of some sort where this skill was conveyed. And so that just is the best logical explanation for its consistency from an early time across tribal boundaries. Again, we don't when we think, well, these are all Germanic people, so they must have all got along. They must have been a part of the same, you know, everything. It's just kind of like we think of a country today. And that was, of course, not true. These tribes fought with one another like, you know, like anything. I mean, they were just competitors fighting, et cetera. But one thing we know about this ancient culture is that there's a couple of types of people that could get pretty free access between and among the various tribes due to the fact that they wanted what they had, these individuals, which were storytellers, poets, things like that, who went from place to place telling news of far away places and such, and entertaining the folks with epic poems and stories and things of that nature. And that same guy might have also been bringing along trade goods, you know, luxury items, etc. He was in trades, poetry, etc. Now that, of course, completely covers a major part of that god Odin. That's not, again, that's not a god, but people who were his followers. They were involved in the trade, so business, trading, as well as poetry and the linguistic arts, if you will. And so these people were given entree from one tribe to another because people wanted what they had and what they offered. And it was more what they knew and what they were able to provide than anything that they physically had, like just a piece of gold or whatever, but it was in their brains that what people wanted. And so these people a school of these kind of people could quickly spread this knowledge throughout all the tribes because of that. There were also, as Tacitus describes, various tribes would be part of a sort of a tribal confederation, and that was all formed by religion, really, that they had a common god or cult, and they would come together periodically for everything, for sacrifices, probably for legal adjudications and religious sacrifices, as well as trade. When they got together, things traded, etc. And so they would come together, and in that context, information could be spread quickly. So all of that really describes how such a thing could happen. But what's really incredibly, what a lot of scholarly runologists today don't sort of, or they ignore some of this, they just say, well, the runes were just an alphabet like any other, and there's really nothing magical about it at all. It's just, that's all just later romanticism, et cetera. Yeah. But, of course, that said, well, why would somebody... if these things came into being, let's say 100 BC or something, and then we go, well, where's the literature? Why didn't they write anything as far as writing on paper or parchment, et cetera? The Romans were doing it. The Greeks were doing it. And they did it quite quickly as far as their alphabet. That's what they invented it for. That's what they used it for. But yet the runes, well, a century goes by, 2, 3, 4, 5, centuries upon centuries, generation after generation, there is no, quote, literature, end quote. They're just these inscriptions. They never used it for writing in the normal sense. What this culture was what historians of writing and linguistics and so forth who call a culture of restricted or limited, obviously, but restricted literacy. And so it was just used for certain things, but not, it wasn't a literate culture. They were illiterate. They used runes, but that, and so that person roughly estimated that no more than 1% of people were literate in runes. at any time throughout the pagan period, even into the Viking Age. So that is something that has markedly separates culture and its literacy and attitude towards literacy of the Germanic peoples versus the Greeks or Romans, who were using writing in a completely different way. And that isn't just a matter of speculation. As I said, centuries go by and there is no literature. Right? Yeah. So you cannot say, well, it was just like Greek or Roman letters, really. But it didn't act that way.
But weren't they pictographic, Stephen, as opposed to, concatenating letters like in ours? I always thought the runes looked like they were meant to be struck with a chisel.
Mm-hmm. Or they were in stone, but most runes were carved into wood, of course. The whole terminology of runes, that's why they call rune staves, which is stick, right?
Yeah.
And that the word for stick became synonymous with rune itself, so that that this was the thing that they mainly carved. And of course, almost all of that is disappeared, but a few things like that have remained because they were in peat bogs, etc., and have survived. We have wooden objects from a very old time, but they were in peat bogs, and that's why. And so, but we know that we only have a super small amount of what was actually carved. Ibn Fadlan, the Islamic traveler and statesman or whatever, that traveled among the Vikings around 900 up through Russia. And, of course, his book on them and other people's became the basis of Michael Crichton's book, Eaters of the Dead, which then became
13th the movie, Warrior.
The 13th Warrior, right? But his thing was just describing these people. It wasn't a story. It was just, well, this tribe does this and that one, and I saw this, and I talked to this guy. And there's a lot of interesting things in there. As regards runes and religion of the Norse and such. These were Swedes called the Rus that he was encountering, but he encountered many tribes and many people that he writes about. But for once, one thing, of course, he describes, he asks one of them that at this funeral where they're burning the body of a chieftain in a ship, and they burn it, as a funerary ritual, and he says, well, why are you doing this? What is this? It's just like so Islamic people. Oh, that's crazy. you Arabs or whoever, you bury your dead, your honored dead, in the ground where worms and things like that eat them, and that's it's disgusting. He says, but we burn our honored dead so that they go at once to paradise. So, there's like a insight right into the attitudes of these people towards their rituals that he provides, unintentionally or just as a matter of, he probably thought these people are crazy. But, and another thing he describes in connection with that also, in how we know that there must have been many runic inscriptions there that are long gone, is that he describes a sort of a graveyard where there are plaques made of birch wood that have, that have on them written things about who's there and what they did and so forth and so on. So he does describe the use of what were probably obviously runes, because that's what these people had, and how they did it. Now, back in Sweden, of course, the same people, exactly the same ones, are often memorialized in the many rune stones that are found in Sweden. There are 5,000 of them just in the countryside that are memorial stones. They aren't really gravestones because they aren't really on the grave. They may be in the environs of it, but what the runic rune stone typically will be on a roadside or somewhere where people will pass by and see it. Now, again, 99% of the people passing by would not be able to read it, but they would know, oh, this is probably just because they're from the area. This is so-and-so stone, you know, this, oh, so we know that. But what it says, we don't know. But when someone does read it, one of those 1% people who does read it, which would be an act of deciphering. Everybody's probably seen one of these stones, a picture of it. And they, of course, they have typically have serpents, and the runes are carved in the body of the serpent in a row. It goes all around the stone and just in this confusing mass. Somebody has to spend a lot of time finding where does this thing start, and then just kind of working it out rune by rune. The system they used was not easy to read. There were a lot of symbols that were meant several sounds, so you would have to sort of know what it said before you read it. It's kind of a shorthand. So what is going on here? Now, at the end of some of these stones, you get the answer. And, of course, it's probably true of all of them, but sometimes they come out and say it. And at the end of them, in the pagan times, it would say, good luck to him that carved it. Good luck to him who is reading it. So it was kind of a magical blessing. It memorialized the person. It also gave credit to everybody involved. It was like reading like credits in a movie. It said, so-and-so, this stone is so-and-so. For this person, and it was carved, it was raised by so-and-so, another guy, and then at the end it'll give the guy who carved its name. So it's memorializing and building up the prestige of several people connected to the person and or to the stone. But at the end, that's the key, is that when reading this, you give boon, you give some kind of blessing. And later on, the stones will, when it's in Christian times, they'll say, God bless him who carved it. God bless him who's reading it. And so this is it gives insight into how the stone works, what it's supposed to do. It's a thing that does something. And which is give benefit through eternity. And I've many times I refer to the runes. They're strong standing eternal runes, Ivar runar, eternal runes, meaning they last forever because they're carved into granite here. And so they have. I mean, so they do still exist, unlike those birch plaques and so forth. Those Swedish runestones are still there, and it's easy to read the day they were carved, you know, as far as their legibility and such. So, but that gives insight into what it was all about, you know, this tribal connection to the Lord, a few actually reference this thing in Russia, these Rus who had trade routes and war. They went down. There was a Viking raid on Iran, more than one, but they sailed these Viking ships across the Caspian Sea and fought. The Eastern Road, as it's called, is little is known about it as compared to what we know about the Western Road, where the Vikings were invading and England and Ireland and all of that sort of thing. And of course, our English language, has a high percentage of Norse words in it, because of course, at the time when the Old English was spoken, the languages were not quite mutually intelligible, but really close. It wasn't hard to understand one another, and we have words like shirt and skirt. That's the same word you know, the way if you said, well, what does it look like? Well, it's kind of a kirtle, you know, thing that just a, that's the word is the same, but the skirt pronunciation is Norse and the shirt pronunciation is English pronunciation of the same word. So, but then it separates out semantically into two different things. But that's, if you just go through the dictionary, look at the etymologies and how many times our words are actually Norse words. Because half of England was under Scandinavian rulership for centuries. So they sort of, and it sort of repaganized much of England, that converted to Christianity, but the Norse were, for the most part, still pagans.
Fascinating, yes. And it reminds me when you were talking about Stephen, about the guy seeing the tribes that were born, their corpses. I remember many years ago dating an Indian girl, and she told me once, you Westerners are insane. In 10,000 years, uh-huh. You're going to run out of land, and you won't have any cities, just cemeteries going for thousands of miles. She's like, burn your corpses. I was like, you know, I just appeared in this mythology. I don't know, you know.
Yeah. It's the same thing. Of course, it's the same Indo-European mindset behind both examples, which wasn't universal. Usually cremation early on was something that was a higher prestige thing, because it takes a lot of effort to burn a body. Mm-hmm. Yeah. You know, I mean, it takes a lot of BTUs, a lot of wood, it's a complex thing.
Yeah, but God ain't creating any more land, as the saying goes. So you're gonna run. Yeah.
Well, and like Germany and places, you know, so like in Germany, they bury people. If you're not somebody important, they're gonna dig you up. I mean, this gonna be, you're gonna be dug up.
Yeah, and Mexico too. Yeah.
Somebody else buried there. I mean, it's like, 'cause land is very. There it is, running out in the sense that they do that. I mean, it seems weird, but that's happened. That happens all the time. That's enough. And that's, you've been there long enough out, you're evicted. But that's kind of, in the ancient times, what happened. This mindset is a Germanic one in a way, very much so in the sense that these grave mounds that have, goods and treasures in them and so forth, if you find them intact, but usually, and this is described in the sagas and elsewhere, the grave mounds were, after a certain period of time, tribal tradition or clanic tradition would dictate, after a certain amount of time, the family would go into the grave and retrieve certain things, for example, weapons, swords, etc., under the belief that they are already reborn. They're not there anymore. They are on to other things. For example, this little boy over here is him, reborn. Mm, how do we know that? Well, we gave him his name. Okay, he is the grandfather. Actually, the German word for grandson is Enkel, which etymologically means little grandfather. And in words like names such as, which is a Gothic name, Gothic tribe name, that the Huns had a lot of Gothic names because they'd kind of amalgamated themselves ethnically. Attila, famous Attila the Hun. Attila means little father, literally. Atta, the Gothic Lord's Prayer starts off, Atta Unsar, our Father. And so Attila, the ill thing, just is a diminutive. So Attila means little father, which means he's the father reborn. Oh, you know, he's come back. And that's the ancient Germanic, and now Indo-European probably, but certainly well attested in Germanic tradition, that the ancestors are reborn in their descendants, and the naming practices show that they would not they would name their children after dead ancestors, believing them to be reborn in them. Sometimes in the sagas and elsewhere, you see where a father will display certain behaviors towards his son, which he had displayed towards his father, signs of respect, etc., because of the belief that he actually was him. So
fascinating.
Yeah, that's I wrote my master's thesis on kind of that topic, and the Sigurd saga, how his the great hero, the dragon slayer Sigurd, is actually his father, Sigmund, reborn. And you can tell that in the saga itself, because it's said of this Volsung clan, which is descended from Odin, that they have special powers. Among the special powers is a clan, all Volsungs can take poison on the outside of their bodies, like venom or whatever. But only the head Volsung, the actual head of the tribe, can ingest poison and live and be, you know, it's fine. So Sigmund can do that. Sigmund is killed under the influence of Odin, who actually causes him to die. Why? He's cultivating his son, who's still in the womb. And Sigmund says to his wife, he says, "You are carrying our son, who will be the greatest hero of our people of all time." And so he dies, and then Sigurd is born. And I'm going to go through the whole story. A lot of people know it. Wagner used this for his template and everything. But he has this moment where he kills this dragon, Fafnir, and he's afraid at first that this, because he doesn't know all of his powers or anything, but that he's going to get this venom and blood of the serpent on him, which would normally just burn somebody up like acid. Germanic dragons spit acidic goo. They didn't breathe fire. They spit this stuff. And so he was worried about that. But Odin tells him not to be worried. Just dig a trench. Let it just flow onto you. And he does that. That's fine. And it didn't hurt me. And then at one point, he's got the heart of this dragon with the blood bubbling up on it. And he sticks it, he tests it with his finger to see if it's done, because he's going to eat the heart of this dragon to get its power. And he's actually supposed to give it to his foster father, but that didn't work out because of this. He sticks his finger on there, and he puts the finger in his mouth and ingests the heart blood of this acidic, monstrous dragon, which would normally just kill a guy. But instead of that, he can understand the language of the birds around him, which tell him your foster father is setting you up and he's going to kill you. So he just goes and kills him first, of course. And but see that the whole gist of the story, we usually get lost in the fairy tale dimensions of it, but what it's saying there is this guy is his father, who had those powers, because that's what's reborn. It's not like what's reborn. It's not the thing like, well, 200 years ago on Christmas morning, I ate, shepherd's pie. I remember that. No, that's not what's important. It's the essence of the powers and the abilities that are reborn, right?
Yeah, exactly.
And so that's what they're describing. It wasn't like nobody ever. Actually, what the old Icelandic sagas have the same function for the Icelanders as what in our New Age tradition grew up in, I guess, are things like past life regressions, right? I need to know what happened to my soul in the past so I'll be informed about why what's going on with me now. You know, I was burned as a witch, and that's why I'm so afraid of fire. You know, things like that, you know, that people would say. But in the Icelandic sagas, these are past life regressions. This tells you your whole family background and who your ancestors were and what happened to them and who they were. And that is who you are. in this latest incarnation, but you are that. Developing and growing, that's what also the Volsunga saga tells this story about how through the generations, how we went from pretty ordinary people to the most extraordinary, supposedly, in the mythology is said, the most extraordinary individual ever, Sigurd, the greatest hero. And so it tells the story through the generations of how this developed, how this entity developed through various incarnations. So it's kind of, when you decode it, it's a fascinating world there.
Oh, I agree. Yeah, I love this mythology, reincarnation. And in your book, Stephen, you talk about the characteristics of a rune-using culture, and you mentioned four: males-only patron had to be Odin, practical religious uses, and the runes maintain their traditional order. So that's a good framework. And I wanted to ask you, in Germanic culture, like, let's say, the Greeks or the Aztecs, could a god possess you, since we are kind of talking about living gods talking to you? Was there such a thing?
Well, not exactly. It would be descended, like a person, or you would be incarnated through generations that a god would, is really... Gods are the ancestors of us all, because after all, what is Odin called? And one of his most famous names, of which there are several, a couple of hundred, is Allfather, the father of all. So, well, he is the god of consciousness, and as a species, that's our gift. He endows humanity at their creation with consciousness. That's told in the Volus poem. And so we're all incarnations of that, but possession by a god, that just doesn't happen, because you're already a latent god to begin with.
No, that makes sense.
So it's a matter of unfolding it and actualizing it through heroic action, through symbolic action, in all sorts of ways. In Sather, the practice of soothsaying that you find in the Norse tradition, some people in current influenced by voodoo practices or other things like that, where people are, quote, possessed, or shamanism, etc., where somebody might be possessed or ridden by a god, so forth. People have incorporated or imagined that to be the case. But if we read which I've wrote a book with my colleague James Chisholm about, just a source book of this Sæth practice, where you see all of the examples in the Norse tradition or Norse literature of this practice of soothsaying, where gods are, or entities, I'll put it that way, DC and other things, are attracted to the practitioner. Now, in modern practice, you oftentimes see people have reinterpreted that in style of these other exotic traditions. But what we actually see there is that the seeress, usually that's a woman, sits there and does these songs, or has people do these songs, then the entities are attracted to her environment, and then they inform her, but she doesn't speak. It's specifically said, that she sits there in silence, and then after it's over, she then just speaks as in a conversational way. Yeah. Well, that's the thing. She, would get the, and if you hear, there's a current practitioners who put on a show of, I'm possessed by this god or that, and speak in weird voices and such and so forth. But, basically, we're just going back to mediumism, medium type of phenomena from the spiritualistic movement. But so there's a hunger or thirst for that, but that's just not the way it's described.
Wonderful. Well, first, okay. Vance, thanks for keeping us company. I don't know if you have another pun.
I enjoyed it.
Yeah. No, I'm all out of them. Okay. But yeah, I appreciated learning all these things about the runes. Much different than the old 20th century reinvention of them. I do want to mention to the listeners that do not spell rune-guild with a U. Don't say G-U-I-L-D. It's G-I-L-D, yeah. Right, Stephen? Because the other site. The other site is a trap, so be careful. You wanted me to change my browser and install a plugin.
Oh my God.
Yeah, so
we should have a thing. I'll put a thing on Facebook or something about that.
Yeah, that's a good idea. So runeguild.org.
Thank you, Vince.
And that's, yeah.
Thanks for all the info, Stephen.
Yes, Stephen, we appreciate all the work you've done, and thanks for your time, and good luck with everything.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir. I appreciate your wishes of good luck.
And there you have it, my beloved True Seekers. Our first part of our interview with Stephen Flowers. In our second part, you know I would ask Stephen if there are any parallels between Gnosticism and Norse mythology. You know it, and he answers. Stephen will share if there are any films that do justice to runes, Germanic traditions, or Norse metaphysics. We'll double back, and he'll continue giving us more on the history of runes with incredible insights. This includes the magical secrets of runology and even rune secret societies, as well as a lot of history on Germanic, Anglo-Saxon, and Norse history, and much more. So consult your runes and please become a Patreon or AB Prime member for the full magical consultation. Only $6.99 a lunar cycle, or whatever you want to pledge on Patreon. You won't find this Gnostic or Hermetic content or many of our guests anywhere in cyberspace or even meat space. When you subscribe, it will cost you about $1 per episode, and that's a deal of many lifetimes. Membership includes full access to more than 14 years of quality interviews. It includes an invitation to the Inner Sanctum of Gnosis Facebook group and the Discord channel, where many past guests hang out there, and I'm always there to answer your questions. Even support in the form of some shekels to PayPal or the US mail really, really helps. Don't forget I'm offering voiceover services if you need some audio for your projects. I also have the merch store and an Amazon wish list, as I always need equipment in this universe of entropy. The Finding Hermes program is live, and so are our virtual Alexandria exclusive private meetings that include exercises loyal to the ancient Gnostics, and a whole lot of stimulating conversation and a Q&A. I've already given lessons on Gnostic chants, vowel magic, sex magic, entheogens, astral ascents, mystical Eucharist, and much more. If you want to understand and experience in its full impact and liberating secrets, become an official citizen of the virtual Alexandria. Lastly, I am now on Odyssey and Rockfin, moving away from the larger digital domains and going to places that don't censor and accept crypto. Check me out there. You can do so many wonders, I just know it. I just know it. And like Elliot Alderson, Thunder, and those ancient rune magicians, you can make a difference in the world. You matter. You are amazing. Thanks for being here. Thanks for being yourself, your true self, here in the desert of the real. Hello and goodbye, as always.